Oh, Electronic Arts. Oh, electronic gamers don't like single-player games anymore, arts. It's been no secret lately that EA haven't been doing too well in regards to their business practices, so much that YouTube journalists literally cannot make videos fast enough. The amount of screw-ups, mishaps, and moments of pure, unadulterated stupidity is so massive that I'm shocked I was able to narrow it down to just 10. And I even grouped some things. There isn't too much to explain here. I hate EA, you hate EA, everybody bloody hates EA. Let's mock the crap out of them. Funny thing about real-life video game economics, the harder you make it to play the game, the more people will try to find ways around it to spite you and make you lose more money. Example, there was a period of time where the used game market was considered the devil. So the solution at the time was called the Online Pass, which was included in each brand new copy of a game. This pass allowed you to access supplemental features such as online multiplayer. TLDR, buy the game used, you had to shell out more and more money to play online. They implemented this across many of their franchises, including, but not limited to, Dragon Age, Need for Speed, Mass Effect, Battlefield, Dead Space, and all EA sports titles. Naturally, this did not sit well with gamers. Hey, you wanna bring your new game over to a friend's house?
More money, please! More money, please!
People seem to forget that for a while, gamers were afraid that this was gonna be the future of gaming. But they shouted loud enough and hurt EA's sales enough to the point where they eventually removed it. I guess you can count on EA to do the right thing. After they tried everything else first. In the same vein of treating the used game market as the enemy and trying way too hard to combat piracy, behold the Xbox One. Before wising up, this glorious conflagration of bad design and even worse PR required a constant online connection and lacked the ability to play used or borrowed games without a fee. You might be thinking, oh, heavens to Betsy, where did these deplorable rapscallions acquire such a nasty scheme? Well, my oddly old-fashioned fans, they might have gotten the idea from SimCity 2013. EA decided to launch their SimCity reboot with an always-online requirement to combat piracy. Now, there are games out there that always require an online connection, but those games are likely online multiplayer games like League of Legends and World of Warcraft. It's kind of expected. SimCity is a single-player game. There is absolutely no reason it needs an online connection to a verification server. Oh, and it gets better. You think after the fiasco of Diablo 3 that companies would have realized, hey, maybe we should stress test the servers before we launch the game. Well, like someone whose neighbor gets robbed, EA thought that wouldn't happen to them. They were wrong. Very wrong. So, you want a plane? In a nuclear submarine? Deployed to Iraq? Router on the fritz? EA servers down?
Sucks to be you!
And like a smothering parent with a rebellious teen, EA's efforts to combat piracy only strengthened it. Dedicated hobbyist hackers cracked SimCity so that everyone could actually play the game they paid $60 for, despite EA's insistence that the game was built as an online-only game and couldn't be played offline. The backlash was so bad that EA offered one of 8 free games to purchasers of this dumpster fire, including the previous and playable offline SimCity. I don't have a joke there. That's just funny. When it comes to first-person shooters, EA really likes to aim them at its own foot. Remember Medal of Honor, the franchise that used to give Call of Duty a run for its money? Well, after ignoring the franchise for years and waiting too long as Infinity Ward built up a solid reputation with Modern Warfare 1 and 2, they decided to hop on the trendy bandwagon and move Medal of Honor to the modern day. But remember, this is the time when EA hadn't realized that not all publicity is good publicity. They ticked off multiple veterans groups in Canada, England, and America by letting people play as the Taliban. Now, this isn't that egregious, but it is a mild case of too soon. Not only that, but intelligence agencies noted there were sensitive details contained in the game that shouldn't be public knowledge, indicating a possible operational security leak. But the icing on this disaster of a cake was releasing it between underdog favorite Battlefield Bad Company 2 and the incredibly hyped Call of Duty Black Ops. Not only were they late to the party, but they pitted their own gains against each other. And what do you know, history repeated itself with Titanfall 2. As stated in my countdown Overshadowed Games, Titanfall was a game without a great pedigree that was going up against the very hyped Battlefield 1 and the seemingly immortal Call of Duty Infinite Warfare, without customers' knowledge that the game was going multi-platform. They also screwed up a lot with Battlefield 5, but we'll get to that later. For some reason, EA seems to believe that they can do no wrong and gamers will just eat up anything they throw out. Yeah, about that. Okay, while I'm not a fan of the series, I'm willing to give Mass Effect the credit it deserves. The characters, the overall narrative, the visuals and sound, all of that and more made Mass Effect 2 one of the most loved games in recent years. Mass Effect 3 was also well received, controversial ending notwithstanding, so imagine the excitement of the fans when Mass Effect Andromeda was announced. And now imagine the disappointment of the fans when Mass Effect Andromeda was released. Pretty much everyone who has played Mass Effect Andromeda can agree that it's a broken mess. Forget me griping about the cover-based shooting for 2 seconds and just take a look at this glorious pit stain. Bugs and glitches were everywhere, the story has no idea what to do with itself, and oh sweet merciful chakra farted, what happened to your face? This is apparently because EA decided to outsource much of Andromeda's development to smaller branches of the company to cut costs, particularly its animation and modeling. Theoretically, yes, this is a cheaper way to do things, but EA was clearly not careful with this practice and it became a case of too many cooks in the kitchen. Now, let's get one thing clear here. Outsourcing development is a common practice in the industry, and many developer studios wouldn't get a chance in the limelight if this didn't happen. However, it's usually for porting already existing games, not handing the reins of the future of the franchise. That's like working hard on a masterful painting and then asking a 5-year-old to finish it with crayons. Great job, Billy! This'll go on the fridge. For about a week before I put it into the trash. Dante's Inferno was a decent game. I mean, it had some cool ideas, and yeah, Dante's Inferno is a great source of inspiration, but turning what was essentially a black comedy road trip into an overly dramatic, gritty God of War clone? It's a bit weird. But that doesn't stop it from being a fun game at points, so long as you don't think about it too hard. And ignore the atrocious advertising stunt that EA attempted. When marketing Dante's Inferno, EA decided to hire some fake Christian picketers, saying the game is evil and you'll go to hell. EA actually confirmed this was their intention, and let me tell ya, many people were not happy with this practice, and for giving Kotaku a reason to write a snide article saying, well, yeah, the marketing is insulting and misleading, but you're Christian so you deserve it, we're real games journalists. I think the marketing department meeting went a little like this.
Okay, advertising this game is challenging, what are we gonna do to spice it up? Huh, how about alienating the largest religion in the Western world by manufacturing controversy? Or maybe we could draw more inspiration from the source material?
The source material, which is basically an exploration of the complicated facets of sin and how one can easily slip down those slopes without realizing?
I mean, yeah, that's
stupid. Let's tell our customers who pay our salaries that they're going to hell instead.
Please stop yourself.
And while we're at the end, let's showcase Dante naked and set up for Dante's Purgatorio, which we are 100% sure will come out.
Can I request hazard pay?
Hey guys, did you know that Apple once had a console? The Apple Pippin. It wasn't intended to be a serious games console, so it was short-lived. Did you know that EA once had a console too? And they shockingly took it more seriously.
Definitely. Cool.
Sorta. Behold the 3DO. It had some pretty good processing power for the time. That it decided to squander on playing games with awful full motion video, games that were easily pirated due to lack of software security, games that were really bad due to lack of quality control, and games that it tried to market which were already available on other consoles like the PlayStation. Yeah, if the PlayStation managed to curb stomp Nintendo of all companies, you have a snowball's chance in hell. But we haven't gotten to the real kicker. The 3DO retailed for $699 US in 1993. If we adjust for inflation, that's over a grand.
Mock the PS3 and its giant enemy crabs all you want. It wasn't this bad. Where's my dance remix of Take Your Dang Clothes Off, Internet?
While while it still has its kinks, I like to think that the gaming industry has grown up over the years. Nowadays, we're seeing and celebrating a lot more female protagonists in widely loved games. Lara Croft, Horizon Zero Dawn, A Hat in Time, Mass Effect 3 pushed the idea of canon femship, Halo and Black Ops added females to their multiplayer, and coming up is the next in the cult classic franchise, Darksiders 3. Aside from noisy misogynists complaining from the depths of 4chan, people are perfectly accepting of the idea of female protagonists and female warriors. And EA manages to screw that up too with Battlefield 5. Where to freaking start with this game? I suppose we could talk about their strange choices for chat filtering. For instance, you can't say DLC unless the word free precedes it. Subtle. You can't say Nazi either, even though this is set in World War II. You also can't say white man because apparently that's a slur now? Have we entered Wonderland? There's no way that wasn't intentional. I suppose we should have all seen this coming when they opened with that embarrassing Trevor Noah promo, but whether you're left or right of the political spectrum, haphazardly inserting politics into your games almost never works out. See Call of Duty World War II for that one. Yes, EA ever riding the coattails of their biggest rival and being such shining beacons of doing everything right, figured it would totally work out if they did it. Cue the Battlefield 5 trailer's glorious dislike ratio. Why did this happen? Well, for publicly admitting to intentionally putting forth the suggestion that not only would a female soldier be fighting on the British front lines in World War II, but a handicapped female soldier would be fighting on the British front lines in World War II, and calling everyone who says otherwise uneducated and to not buy the game if you don't like it.
All you care about is money. This town deserves a better class of criminal.
Let's be real here. Yes, there were females in World War II, and their stories deserve to be told. I would play the heck out of a mission starring the Night Witch's bombing regiment, or heck, Nancy Wake's stealth missions sound awesome, but showcasing females fighting in the British front and claiming it's plausible and historically accurate is dishonest and disrespectful to the men and the women who sacrificed everything in World War II. If Battlefield 5 intended on being alternate universe historical fiction or was being ludicrously facetious like Dynasty Warriors and was upfront about it, they would have better ground to stand on. And honestly, I would be 10 times as forgiving if they responded more gracefully to the backlash like Call of Duty did. But no, I'm putting this so high on the list because of the way they doubled down and belittled their detractors. And for trying to disguise their thinly veiled laziness and greed as progressiveness, but I digress. And guess what? After the huge backlash and being 85% behind in pre-orders, they eventually backpedaled.
So you guys heard the feedback.
Yeah.
You kind of, you know, went back to the, not went back all the way to the drawing board, but you were
we dialed it back a bit, yeah. Right? Like it was pretty crazy. There were a lot of things out there.
I guess that conviction to be plausible goes away pretty fast. I get the sentiment that EA wants to be inclusive, and I say go ahead. Make a game about the Tuskegee Airmen. Make a game detailing the issues of being the first female Green Beret. Make a game about Boudicca or Joan of Arc. Make the game about the minority. Don't just throw them in for some cheap brownie points so you can pat yourself on the back for your dishonest, rose-tinted historical revisionism. Instead of coddling your daughter by sticking her in a bubble and telling her that she can't have a creatable character that looks like her because she's a girl, how about be a freaking parent and tell her because it's freaking World War II and it wouldn't be right?
We may not like that it happened, but pretending it didn't happen is like pretending that JFK didn't get shot and the ramifications for our country didn't happen. By all means, tell history, but tell the freaking truth.
Quote the MC from Cabaret, money makes the world go round, right? I mean, that seems to be EA's end goal in every single problem I pointed out thus far. Save money and make more money while putting in as little effort and coherent thought as possible. But when EA nickel and dimes people by tickling their nostalgia with games that either have diehard fans or a series they haven't touched in a while, then you have a problem. Mobile gaming is usually just a cash grab anyways, but EA took Play-Doh fans like a kazoo. Wanna get the goodies faster? Pay up. Wanna get more of the story or true endings? Check please. Need more stamina or the actual freaking dungeons? Nom nom nom, money tastes good! Some mobile games do it right. Fire Emblem Heroes does make you pay to get summoning orbs faster, but if you're patient and diligent, you can build up orbs fairly easily by letting you actually play the game. But Dungeon Keeper Mobile milked you dry based on nostalgia alone while giving you no other option to progress other than paying through the nose. And Command & Conquer Mobile? After killing and assimilating every company that worked on the franchise and leaving it dead for years, they decide in their infinite wisdom to revive it as a mobile game. And of course you have the infamous loot boxes. In Battlefront 2, you basically had to pay in order to get the chance to unlock certain items, characters, maps, etc. because building up the in-game credits took 3 days to do properly. And since they hid like 82% of the good stuff behind paywalls, of course you'd have people pretty much going into debt in order to play as Darth Vader. This immoral practice even sparked congressional debate and got loot boxes as a concept banned in Belgium. You can hide your games behind paywalls or revive a franchise for a mobile game and get some bad press, but the force be with you if you tick off rabid Star Wars aficionados. Watch out, they bite.
Dearly beloved, today we are gathered in fellowship and solidarity to mourn those who have tragically lost their lives. A moment of silence for the fallen.
Spend all your time waiting for that second chance and the endlessness that you feel. You were pulled from the wreckage of your soul.
Yes, they will be missed by those who cared for them. Please send your condolences to the nearest EB Games. Oh, too soon.
You know, I could excuse everything on this list. I could ignore the legal battles they've gotten themselves into, the backlash from fans, journalists, and other industry leaders alike. I can even accept the fact that mostly everyone seems to already hate EA, including me and most of America. No problem, they've earned the title. Kudos, you're the best at something, yay you. But you take advantage of, belittle, mistreat, and work your employees to the brink of illness and exhaustion and don't pay them accordingly for it?
You are on my shit list.
One of the most prominent examples I can give you is that of the EA Spouse, a 2004 live journal detailing the grueling working conditions the author's partner had to put up with. It went from 48 hours a week to 85 hours a week with, and I quote, no overtime, no compensation time, no additional sick or vacation leave. That means that those extra 8 to 45 hours that they worked just weren't paid for. EA used to give them time off at the end of a project, but they decided, nah, fam, onto the next Madden game. They can handle it, right? No. Apparently, EA's unethical practices extend even to their workforce because their motto is, and again I quote, put up or shut up and leave. This is the core of EA's human resources policy. And since EA gobbles up other companies like sushi at a revolving bar, these talented, passionate people are running out of places to run to. Thankfully, a class action lawsuit spurred by the LiveJournal post cost EA $15.6 million. Great, are you actually paying your people what they're worth? No, literally 2 years later, another suit was filed that cost EA $14.9 million. Probably would have cost half of that to actually pay your people what you should have, or hire more people to lighten the load, or both. And while the situation across the entire gaming industry has improved slightly with crunch time being paid more properly and is less frequent, it's still an issue. Not only do managers set either unrealistic deadlines or softly manipulate their workers to break their backs for the game, employees fall into this unhealthy lifestyle without even realizing it. According to Marie Jacela Gall, students and young new entrants to the industry see crunch and unpaid overtime as price of admission. This becomes dangerous, and higher-ups take advantage of this mindset by advertising employment to people who love games and wouldn't mind selling their best years to work on Madden 2020. It still goes on, and to this day, I'm very hesitant to touch a single one of EA's games if I can help it, which means, yeah, unless EA gets their crap together, I'm refusing to play Anthem, which sucks because it looks really cool. Their employees do amazing work most of the time and deserve to be compensated for it. I just wish the parent company breathing down their brilliant necks was a lot more ethical.
I'm the Fiery Joker, and if I wanted to gamble my money away, I wouldn't buy loot boxes, EA. I'd invest in your company.
Cut!